Hey, Girl Scouts. I hope you guys are having a great Wednesday. My name is Brooke, and this is Ziggy, and today we are working on our Cadet Animal Helpers badge. So as some of my friends start to hop on and join us, if you want to say your name, where you're from, and your favorite animal, we'll go ahead and wait a couple minutes to get started. My favorite animal is dogs. I just love dogs. So, again, if you want to write in the comments your name, where you're tuning in from, and your favorite animal. And I do have some treats on my computer, so that's what Ziggy keeps looking at. I have my other dog here with me too today. Her name is Bonnie. She's down here taking a nap. So, we'll meet them in just a minute. So Lena, or Amar said hello. She loves dogs. West Virginia Troop 32812 is here. And it looks like Kaylee likes dogs as well, so that's really exciting. Dogs are my favorite. My second favorite animals are hippopotamuses. I do really like hippos. I think they look like my dog Bonnie. So it looks like we have a friend from Washington, New Jersey, Troop 94681, Unicorns and Dogs. Kate from Watertown, Connecticut, and her favorite animal is sloths. Sloths are super cool. I loved sloths when I was little. I did my third grade book report on sloths. So if you're just tuning in, my name is Brooke. I am a program manager here at Girl Scouts of Western Ohio's Southern Region. I'm coming to you live from my home in Cincinnati, Ohio. And today we are going to be talking about the Cadet Animal Helpers badge. So I'm really excited to have so many friends here tuning in. And if you're just now hopping on, go ahead and write in the comments your name, where you're tuning in from, and also your favorite animal. And also, my computer is acting really glitchy with the video. So if someone can write in the comments and let me know if that's happening for you guys too. I want to make sure I restart the video if I need to. And just so you guys know, this Animal Helpers badge is a cadet badge. Cadets are Girl Scouts in 6th, 7th, and 8th grade, but all of the activities that we're going to be talking about today are definitely suitable for girls of all ages. So you don't have to be in 6th, 7th, or 8th grade. But if you are in 6th, 7th, or 8th grade, then what we're talking about today can help you earn your Animal Helpers badge. And if you're not in 6th, 7th, or 8th grade, then it might help you earn a different badge. Okay, it looks like Trish said no, the video is good for her. Sounds good. I'm excited. I didn't want to have to restart. So we're going to hop into the badge work. Today we are working on our Animal Helpers badge. And this badge has five steps, all of our cadet badges do. So the steps from this badge are step one is going to be. Let me get my notes pulled up. Explore the connection between humans and animals. So, we're going to be doing most of that step today. And then, step two will be to find out how animals help keep people safe. Now, in the description, I did not say that we would be working on this one, but I did find while I was doing research for the other steps a couple of good stories that I thought I could share and we could actually earn the second step together. So we will be working on that. Step three is to know how animals help people emotionally. We'll be doing part of that, but you will have some homework to finish that step. Step four is to check out how animals help people with disabilities. And I do have some YouTube links that you guys can check out and some suggestions that you guys can do on your own to do that part. And then step five is look at how animals might help us in the future. So, again, we won't be covering that step, but I do have a suggestion for how you can cover that at home. So I am going to go a little bit out of order because I do have the dogs here with me and I don't know how long that'll last. So the step that I'm going to be covering first, and we'll kind of get them both on camera, is step three, which is to find out how animals help people emotionally. So the suggestion for this step is to talk to 5 pet owners about how their pets make them feel better. So you guys are talking to me today, and then you'll need to talk to 4 other people. And one thing that I think would be really cool is while you're talking to your friends or your neighbors or family members, I think this is a great thing to do while we're social distancing. You can work it into, I like to try to call my grandparents maybe once every other week. So you could work it into a call with your grandparents if they have pets, or different things like that. Make a point to call your aunt or uncle. So like I said, you have to talk to 5 different people. Today we're going to talk to me. That'll be one of your 5 people. And then your homework will be to talk to 4 more people. But I think it'll be a great topic to talk about while you're social distancing and checking in on your friends and neighbors and family members. And I think it would be really fun to ask them if they think their animals have helped them while they're practicing social distancing and kind of working through this pandemic. So my kind of story of how my pets make me feel better is I have a cat too, but he really likes to hide. He doesn't like to come around. So we won't be seeing him today, but I have 2 beautiful puppy dogs here. This one is Ziggy, and they are being bribed, obviously. So this is Ziggy right here. Ziggy is about 3 years old. We adopted him in 2018. And he is some sort of Jack Russell mix. He's not full Jack Russell, but he's kind of a Jack Russell mix. And then my other dog here is Bonnie. See, I said it wasn't going to last long, them being here. So my other dog is Bonnie. Bonnie is 11 years old. And she is a puggle, which means she's half pug, half beagle. And she was adopted in 2016, so almost 4 years ago now. And she is the first pet that I ever had on my own. So I always grew up with animals. I've always loved having dogs and different things like that. When I was little, I had hermit crabs, and we always had fish and a cat. But the dogs were always my favorite. So especially when I was in college, I would get so sad that I didn't have a dog all the time. I'm gonna put her up here so you can see her better. So as soon as I could adopt a dog of my own, I did. Now, dogs are a big responsibility. So I definitely did think it through before I made the decision to get Bonnie. But some of the reasons that I got her in particular are, one, I love, love, love pugs. I just think they're so cute, and I love their little smooshy noses. Bonnie has a nice smoosh nose like a pug. So I really loved the breed, but also I knew she would make a good apartment dog. So I adopted her right after I graduated from college. I had actually moved to a new city, and I was living in a really tiny apartment. I didn't have any friends, so I was actually having a really hard time kind of living on my own for the first time. I wasn't in my college town where all my friends were. I was in a whole new city. So Bonnie actually really helped me during that time. She is a great lazy dog. She just likes to sleep, and she's an older dog. She's a senior dog. So she made a great apartment dog, and she really helped me during that time in my life because she was a friend to me. She was someone that I could talk to, as cheesy as it is. I do love to talk to my dogs. And even just petting a dog helps you de-stress. And I lived very close to a dog park, so me and Bonnie would actually go to the dog park every single day. It was our favorite activity, and it gave her some social interaction with other dogs, but then it also gave me a chance to have some social interaction and talk to the other dog's owners. So that's how Bonnie kind of helped me when I first got her. But now, as we're facing social distancing and this pandemic, my dogs have definitely been a huge help, you know, even just on some of the days where, you know, you feel really cooped up in the house, just taking them out for a walk or to the park can really help with that. And again, just petting the dogs is a big de-stressor for me. I talk to my dogs all the time. And my dogs love to lay under my desk while I'm working. So I'm on my couch right now because I figured you guys would be able to see them. But I have a picture of them laying under my desk last week. My dogs love to cuddle with each other. So here are my dogs, Bonnie and Ziggy, laying under my desk. And one thing that's really interesting is I've talked about how my dogs have helped me, but my dogs have actually helped each other. So I got Bonnie about 4 years ago and Ziggy about 2 years ago. And Bonnie would get really nervous and anxious when we left the house. So actually having another dog really helped calm her anxiety and her nerves and being home alone. And they love to spend time together. They love to hang out with each other. They're each other's best friends. And they love to snuggle and curl up in the window and watch all the cars and the people go by. So I know we went out of order, but that is step three, know how animals help people. So that's how my animals help me. Now you have to talk to four other people about how their animals help you. So again, this would be a great thing to add into like a phone call to a friend or relative, if you're already calling them or Skyping them or doing some kind of video call. So that's step three. Now we're going to jump into step one. So step one is explore the connection between humans and animals. And for this step, I researched how the views of animals have changed over the centuries. So the suggestion was to find 10 different ways that the views of animals have changed over the centuries. And I'm going to be going over 8 of them. So it looks like Abigail said, hi, thanks for doing this. Will this be recorded so we can have the kids watch it again later? Yes, all of our Facebook Live videos can be found either on our YouTube channel or if you go to the Girl Scouts of Western Ohio Facebook page and hit videos, we have all of the videos and we've been doing our Facebook Lives since the first week of quarantine here in Ohio at least. So we have quite a few videos on there. We have a lot of different activities that you can do. So you can definitely go back and watch this later on either of those channels. So for the 8 different things that I found of how animal views on animals have changed over the centuries, the first one is 100 years ago, nearly all dogs were kept for herding, pulling, hunting, tracking, or protection. So people really owned dogs for to do a job 100 years ago. And Tori Hawk in... I don't know when it was, but she did a Senior Voices for Animals badge and she talked, her sister-in-law was in the video and they talked about how different animals have different purposes. So my dogs kind of fit into some of the different purposes. Come here, Ziggy. Ziggy would have been a hunting dog. Jack Russells were bred for hunting and things like that. I don't know the exact purposes, but I do know that they were a type of hunting dog. So that's why people would have kept dogs like Ziggy around to help hunt small animals and things like that. My parents have a really cute miniature pincher, and they were actually German dogs that were bred to kind of kill small vermin and things like that. So dogs were really kept for a purpose, kept to help out the family, kept to work in some way. Now today, some dogs are still kept for those purposes. I know we have family friends that keep dogs for duck hunting and things like that. But a lot of times dogs, even if they are kept for those purposes, are kept for companionship now too. So Bonnie, my other dog, my Puggle, come here, Bonnie. Are you gonna come? She's not going to come for me. But she is a half pug, half beagle. So beagles, again, are another type of hunting dog. But pugs were invented in kind of the toy dog craze. So they were completely bred just to be our best friends and to love us and to hang out. So even though we do still keep dogs for some purposes now, a lot of dogs are kept for companionship. And another fact that goes along with that are between 100 years ago, all the dogs would have stayed outside for the most part. They would sometimes come in if it was cold, but now 60 to 80% of dogs sleep in their owner's bedrooms. So I know both of my dogs sleep in my bedroom with me. They're definitely a part of the family. So my second fun fact of how the views of animals have changed is in 1995, 55% of pet owners referred to their pets by or referred to themselves as their pet's mom or dad. So only 55%. In 2001, that number had increased to 83%. And I think now it would be much higher. I definitely treat my dogs like my children and refer to myself as their mom, even though they're not my children. So the third thing that I found is the bond between humans and their pets has changed the field of veterinary medicine. So because the connection has become so strong between dogs, or really any animals, and their humans, veterinary medicine has really had to make a lot of different strides. So there's more focus on making dogs more comfortable and less stressed. And there's also been a lot more routine healthcare for animals. So maybe 100 years ago, you wouldn't take your dog in to get its teeth cleaned and things like that. But I know with both of my dogs, we take them to get their teeth cleaned once a year at least, because it's a really important part of keeping your dogs healthy. I also read an article about how a man brought in his dairy cow, which again is an animal that is kept to produce milk to either sell or have milk for the family. And this man had to bring his dog or his cow to the vet. And he said, "I love my cow more than anything. Money is no cost to me. I will do whatever it takes to make sure that my cow is okay." So on that note, my fourth fact is that in 2016, the AAHA released an oncology guidelines for dogs and cats. So what that means is in 2016, they officially released guidelines for treating dogs and cats for cancer. So even like in the 1980s and things like that, if your dog or cat got cancer, that might mean that you had to put the dog down to sleep or the cat down to sleep and they might not be able to make it. But now we have different guidelines for treating animals with cancer and we can do cancer treatments and save them. And from 2006 to 2017, the number of vet oncologists more than doubled. So there are tons more people going into this field so that our little furry friends can stay a part of our family for even longer. So my fifth thing that I found is not about animals that live in the house. It's about animals that live in the ocean. So whales. 100 or thousands of years ago, people began hunting whales for their meat, for their blubber to produce oil, and for the plates that they use to strain the different like food and stuff like that from the water. And in 1946, the International Whaling Commission formed to protect whales. And by this point, many countries have banned whale hunting and protections exist. So even the way that we look at some animals in the wild has changed. Number six, I wanted to see if there were any societies or things like that that really kept animals the same way that we do now. So what I found is ancient Egyptians actually kept a lot of different animals as pets, just as we do now. They're credited for inventing the dog collar and would walk their dogs around on leashes. Most homes had at least one cat. Most of them had multiple cats. And many members of the upper middle class and the upper class had dogs because dogs cost more money to maintain. But dogs were considered members of the household and they were mummified just as humans were when they passed away. I also found at this time that like the kings and queens and things like that also kept like monkeys and different animals like that as pets. So I thought that was really interesting. Number seven is about cats. So cats used to be kept in homes, even in ancient Egypt, I found this. They were kept in homes to keep vermin away. So they kill like small mice and rats and things like that. But now a lot of times if your cat brings you a dead mouse or a dead rat or a dead bird, you're going to be upset with it. I know I personally get excited when my cat kills a mouse because I don't want mice in my house. But a lot of people don't keep mice in their houses anymore keep cats in their houses anymore to get rid of mice. So then my very last fact is about zoos. So zoos were once a place for very rich people to house all of the different animals that they had collected from around the world. It was really a way for them to show how rich they were. And then they started inviting their friends over and really showing off the animals. And then eventually those became open to the public. So that's when zoos were very first invented or started coming around. But now zoos are doing really incredible things. Our zoo here in Cincinnati is a conservation zoo. So they're actually doing a ton of research to help endangered and extinct or animals that are becoming extinct, not go extinct. So zoos are no longer just a place for animals to, or for rich people to show off their animals. They're really helping with taking care of animals and the science of animals and things like that. So it looks like some people said some things about their dogs. So Katie's dog is a Brittany Spaniel and they are bred for hunting. And then one of Megan's dogs is a type of dog I'm not going to try to pronounce, but they are used as farm dogs. But the Chihuahua is the descendant of an ancient companion dog, and it shows. Very interesting. So far, we went out of order. We covered step three, which is to know how animals help people emotionally. And we also covered step one, which is to explore the connection between humans and animals. And I'm sorry that this has been a lot of talking, but hopefully it's been interesting talking at the very least. Donna said that they have a Bichon since he is all white. His name is Casper. They do have a Bichon named Casper. I met Casper. Casper is very cute. Say hi to Casper for me. So, part two of this badge is to find out how animals keep people safe. So while I was researching, I found some really cool stories of how animals have helped keep people safe. And Lena said, how long would this take? I only have a little bit longer. We'll probably be done in the next 8 minutes, but you can hop off and finish it whenever you would like, you so choose. So just a couple of stories of animal rescues. A horse during a three-ring circus act broke from its formation and raced into another ring to save a falling trapeze artist who had tumbled from her wire. She had been working without a net. So that's a story of how a horse saved someone. A gorilla saved a three-year-old boy who fell into her enclosure at the Brookfield Zoo outside of Chicago. The boy had been knocked unconscious, but the gorilla, who carried her own gorilla baby on her back, picked him up, cradled him in her arms, and took him to the door where zookeepers could get him safely. My last story is about dolphins. So dolphins will lift drowning humans onto their backs and up to safety. They rescued a young boy who fell into a marine show in an aquarium tank. And they carried a woman 200 miles through the Indian Ocean to the nearest buoy after her yacht had exploded. Dogs, sea turtles, and even pigs have carried out their own brave water rescues. So step two is to find out how animals keep people safe, and we just read a couple of stories about that. Step three is know how animals help people emotionally, and I actually found some YouTube videos that kind of talk about service dogs. So one of them is a girl who I think is probably in the cadet age range, and she has a service dog to help her with her diabetes. And then another one is a really fun series that I found on BuzzFeed, where they kind of spotlight and show a whole group of service dogs go through their first year of training. And it's really, really fun. It is called Puppy Prep. So I will make sure that I leave that in the comments for this video and also on the event page. So in order to find out more about step three, know how animals, know how animals help people emotionally. Step four is check out how animals help people with disabilities. And that's where those YouTube links are going to come in. So you can watch those YouTube videos of both people who train service dogs and find out a little bit about the characteristics of some of the different breeds that they have at this training school that make them fit for being service dogs. And then also find out more from a family with a girl your age who has a service dog. And then our last step is to look at how animals might help us in the future. So you all are going to get to practice being a scientist, and you're going to make observations about an animal, either in your backyard or inside your home for a whole week. So you will see, you'll practice your scientific skills, and you'll practice your observational skills to observe the dog while they eat. Well, not a dog, whatever animal that you have. Observe the animal while they eat, while they sleep, see how they react to humans. I know at my house, I get deer in my backyard every day. So if I didn't want to observe my dogs, then I could observe the deer that are in my backyard and see how they react to different different human noises and things like that. I could see what they eat, just observe their behaviors for a week and take notes. So that is step five of the badge. So that's how you can achieve all five steps of this badge. I'll just look at the comments really quick to see if any have come in. Oh, it looks like my aunt is on here, and she said, Betty has been fishing with the boys this week. It's her favorite. So my aunt has a Labradoodle or a Golden Doodle, but she's either half Golden Retriever, half Poodle, or half Lab, half Poodle. She's very sweet, and she does love being in the lake. My family lives on a lake, so she loves helping the boys fish. And then Lulu, her cat, has been monitoring the squirrels and the birds. My cat has also been monitoring the squirrels and the birds, and my dogs have been monitoring the street out front. They do like to bark and alert me when the mail comes every day. So those are our five steps of this badge. I will update some of those YouTube links that I talked about in the event page, and I'll go back and add them to the comments here so that you guys can do that as well. And other than that, I hope that you all enjoyed this video. Tune in tomorrow at 10 a.m. where I will be live again. I'll be doing part two of our Daisy Welcome to the Flower Garden journey. So if you missed part one, you can see part one from last week in our videos. And you can also tune in every day at 10 and 2 for our Facebook Lives. If you're not a Girl Scout but have enjoyed doing our Girl Scouting activities, you can visit girlscouts.org/join to find out how to join a Girl Scout troop near you. And as always, if you're doing any of the activities from our Facebook Lives, definitely share your story with us on our Facebook page. I believe it's girlscoutgswo.org/share-your-story. So I hope you all have a great rest of your day, and thank you so much for tuning in. Bye.